Well, good afternoon and welcome to the University of St. Thomas. I guess we should have gotten a bigger room. My name is Doug Hennis. I'm Vice President for Government Relations today. And I am going to introduce you to three speakers and we'll get to show more. Particularly, I want to thank Congresswoman McCollum's office for their work in helping to plan and publicize this forum. They obviously done a very good job. Betty McCollum was elected to Congress in the 4th District, this area, in 2000. At this time, she is a member of the House Appropriations Committee. She's a ranking Democrat on the Interior Environment Subcommittee. She's also a member of the Defense Subcommittee. The Interior Environment Subcommittee appropriated $30 billion last year in federal funds to agencies such as the EPA, the Interior Department, Bureau of Indian Affairs, the Forest Service, National Endowment for the Arts and Humanities, and the Smithsonian. The second speaker will be Dr. John Abraham. John is a professor of thermal sciences here at St. Thomas, and his research is on climate change and energy production and distribution. He has been a faculty member here since 2002 and has more than 170 publications in terms of journal papers, conference presentations, and books. And our third speaker is Dr. Mark Seeley. He's a professor at the University of Minnesota, the author of the popular Minnesota Weather Almanac book, and he is an extension climatologist and meteorologist who works with the National Weather Service and state agencies. We were scheduled to have a fourth speaker today, Daniel Luna from the National Weather Service, but he's a little busy preparing for the latest storm of the century. So please join me in welcoming Congresswoman Betty McCollum.
Thank you very much. We took a few classes here, and it's a great institution. And I was so excited about when we had the conversation with St. Thomas, because I know the leadership John's had, to do a venue on climate change. We've been doing a lot of town hall meetings. I have another one tomorrow on healthcare for seniors, and we've got more coming up into the future. But I kept having people come up to me and say, this is great that we're talking about other things, but we have so many questions on the environment and on climate change. We decided that we heard you loud and clear, and this one is dedicated to working on the issue of climate change and understanding it better. And I really, really, although it was nice to get people clapping and standing for me, I know you all came to really find out what Mark Seeley looked like. In full disclosure, here's my position on climate change. Climate change is real. We're the major contributors, and I'm against apathy on this because we need to deal with what is happening with climate change now. We need to act now. And in a few minutes, you're going to hear from our distinguished scientists about how climate change is already impacting us and why it's urgent to keep acting and address this threat and to protect our planet from its very worst impacts. But before, I want to give you an overview on where I think we are on the fight against climate change. Last year, the Paris Climate Agreement went into effect. Under the leadership of the United States, President Obama was critical in bringing 194 countries together on this historic agreement, including major green gas house emitters like China and India. Now, I'll be the first to tell you, and many of you will agree with me, that the Paris Agreement is not perfect. It was not intended to be a silver bullet to reverse climate change, but rather this agreement was a realistic and absolutely necessary step towards fending off the most devastating effects of climate change by limiting the increase of global temperatures to 2 degrees Celsius. The Paris Agreement, I believe, is vital to progress because it outlines clear objectives and it's a structure for a broader international cooperation to slow climate change and to mitigate its impacts over the decades to come. Now, I believe I know President Trump's position pretty well. His position is also shared by his fellow Republicans in Congress, and it's also their work that is stated to hinder or fully cancel the U.S. obligation in the agreement. They've already taken two steps to do that by eliminating two of the State Department's top programs on climate change prevention. Now, it's beyond their ability to immediately pull out of the Paris Agreement. Mr. Trump and congressional Republicans no doubt will cut the funding in U.S. commitments to the Green Climate Fund, as well as work to keep the tax incentives that are alive and well for the coal industry, and failure to invest in renewable energy with the same kind of zeal. President Trump says he wants to tear up the Clean Power Plan. Now, power plants are our largest source of carbon pollution, and we need to work with industry who wants to clean up that pollution, and there's jobs available in doing that. And President Obama recognized that, the dangers of climate change, and he wanted to act aggressively to help America lead this fight. The Clean Power Plan puts the United States on track to significantly cut carbon emissions from the power plants that we have. And they do it in a manner that's inconsistent with the long-term goals of the power industry, many of them joined at the table. The Clean Power Plan had the added benefit of putting Americans to work while reducing pollution in the U.S. electric system, and also had the ability to hire more people doing jobs, making our homes and our businesses more efficient. The estimated average American family will see its electric bill shrink by $7 each month by 2030 if states deploy cost-effective, energy-efficient investments to secure emission reductions. The added bonus is to public health, and that's not talked about very often because you can't see somebody walking around with asthma. You can't see someone walking around that's going to have a future heart condition because of the air particulate particles that they've been ingesting into their body. So it is estimated that $34 billion will be saved in health benefits by the year 2030. And I have to say, improving people's health is something that should be considered in when we move forward to working towards more cleaner energy options. The power plan rests on strong scientific legal foundation. It provides states with broad flexibility to design and implement tailored plans. It fulfills the EPA's obligation, its statutory obligation, to be responsible to address carbon pollution from the largest sources in our country. Through the leadership of Governor Mark Dayton, our largest utility companies, Minnesota is well on its way to fulfilling its obligations of enjoying a boost to our economy and clean energy jobs. Fossil fuel special interests, and it had a big ally in many of the state attorney generals, including Oklahoma's Attorney General Scott Pruitt, who is now Mr. Trump's EPA administrator. On February 19, 2016, the U.S. Supreme Court temporarily halted the implementation of the Clean Power Plan while legal challenges are being decided in the courts. And this was Governor Dayton's response. He released the following statement, and I quote directly from our governor. While the court's temporary stay is disappointing, it does nothing to diminish our resolve in Minnesota to keep moving forward on clean energy initiatives, including the development of our state's clean power plan. President Obama's strong leadership, nation-building initiatives of some of our state utilities, and my administration's commitment will ensure our state's continued progress. And he went on to say, we understand how vital it is that we keep doing everything in our collective powers to reduce harmful greenhouse gas emissions, improve energy efficiency, and advance Minnesota's clean energy economy. So I'm very proud that Minnesota has shown leadership in this area. And while Minnesota leads, Washington took a major step backwards this week with Scott Pruitt, formerly at the helm of the EPA. And why do I say this? His first speech to EPA officials and employees, he failed to even mention climate change, let alone air or water pollution. Instead, he focused on how he intends to limit the agency and prioritize corporate interests. His record of Attorney General of Oklahoma was defined by his very, very close ties to the oil and gas industry and his constant opposition to environmental standards. While serving as Oklahoma Attorney General, Pruitt was involved in 13 lawsuits against the EPA, including the high-profile cases over regulations on greenhouse gases and mercury pollution. And the emails are out there now for the public to read. 87% of Americans, and 78% of Republicans support actions to address climate change. However, Mr. Pruitt has said the science is subject to considerable debate, and that reasonable minds can disagree on the science behind global warming, and they disagree, they do. I have to say, when I disagreed with my science teacher about my answer in the science test, it did not go well. We had President Obama and Secretary Kerry leading the world to fight climate change. Now I have Mr. Trump, Mr. Pruitt, and a former ExxonMobil CEO, Mr. Tillerson, leading the retreat. It's a tough reality we face, but we shouldn't lose sight of good news because our progress is too important to squander. Action on climate change, it works. According to the EPA, between 2014 and 2015, global greenhouse gas emissions dropped 2.2% and decreased CO2 emissions from fossil fuel combustion. Now, we're all about getting our facts right, so multiple factors alluded to this. Switching from coal to natural gas, a warmer 2015 winter led to decreased demand for heating fuel, and there was a slight decrease in electricity demand. But it was still progress nonetheless. So this clearly demonstrates what we can do collectively to make an impact on climate change. And groups like the Minnesota-based Blue-Green Alliance are bringing labor and the environmental leaders together to prove that we can create win-wins in conservation and sustainable energy, as well as improve our environment and our economy. The Blue-Green Alliance estimates that Minnesota could create 15,000 jobs and save more than $3.1 billion by reducing energy use in municipal buildings, universities, schools, and hospitals, and that means saving tax dollars on heat. So we need to focus on jobs, and we also need to focus on the environment, and we need to focus on reducing carbon emissions. And as we know, Minnesota wants to lead the way by also working on our homegrown energy, wind and sun. So last year, the solar industry added 51,000 jobs. That's a nearly a 25% increase over 2015. One out of every five new jobs in the United States are solar jobs. Solar is only... is only the second largest U.S. energy industry, second only to oil and petroleum, and considerably larger than coal. But this sector doesn't even earn a mention in President Trump's America's First Energy Plan. And a plan, and a quote for our president, will unleash the full power of America's energy, ending the job-killing restrictions on shale, oil, natural gas, and clean, beautiful coal. Now, probably for decades. Oil is going to be part of it. But we need to move with a clean, green energy to replace it, and because we're using those fossil fuels, we need to do everything in our power to reduce their emissions and to make sure that they do not pollute our air and our water. Not only am I on the Interior Appropriations Subcommittee, which funds the EPA, I strongly want you to know, and my role as a lead Democrat, I will oppose any black sliding on environmental progress made over the past four decades, let alone the past 8 years of President Obama. Now, Mr. Trump and the Republican Congress, they will be out there doing what I just outlined, but we will play a strong, strong defense. Now I have another role, a role that might, some of you, I could see some of your faces, she's on the Defense Committee. Well, there's a couple of reasons why I'm on the Defense Committee, and this is one of them. I serve on the House Defense Appropriations Subcommittee, and make no mistake, the Pentagon knows climate change is a real threat to our military readiness and our national security. Refers to it these days. Sea level rise, this is, and I'll be quoting the Navy shortly, sea level rise has the world's largest naval base in North Fork, Virginia. They have seen more than 14 inches of sea level rise since World War I. 10 times a year, entry points connecting roads become impassable because of coastal flooding. By the year, in the year 2100, the University of Concerned Scientists estimates flooding at these bases will occur. Flooding at these bases will occur 280 times a year. And that's where we build our nation's naval defense system. Norfolk is just one of many U.S. critical defense installations seriously vulnerable to sea rise. And you can go out and you can Google what's happening to some of our bases and outposts as we watch the permafrost in Alaska disappear. We literally have radar stations and that they have to be moved before they fall into the ocean. So sadly, I have to say, the partisanship is so poisonous in Washington that Republicans in 2014 and 2015 even attempted to prohibit the Department of Defense from investigating to defend our defenses from climate change. Well, the Pentagon is moving forward. Rear Admiral Jonathan White, former chairman of the Navy's Task Force on Climate Change, says there is no time to spare convincing Congress to act. And to paraphrase him, he says, by the time the seas have risen, the ice will have melted, and there will be no turning back. So there are many reasons to act on climate change, but I thought you should know what I'm doing on the Defense Subcommittee, working on climate change. Abraham, but I want to just say a few things about our guests who could not be with us. Dan Luna, at the National Weather Service, he's the meteorologist in charge of the Twin Cities Forecast Office. And his focus, his mission, and this is why we have to be vigilant about what's going on with Britain, their mission, which is part of the National Oceanic Atmosphere Administration, which we refer to as NOAA, spells out clearly to provide weather, water, and climate data forecasts for warnings for the protection of life, property, and the enhancement of our national economy. So no, make no mistake, federal funding for climate research is under attack. NOAA is under attack. Climate research has endured a 30% cut since 2010, folks. And in 2016, those are funding levels below 2006. The funding levels at NOAA, with all this going on right now, are less than are the same as they were in 2006. And we know that NOAA and the Weather Service just got a 10% across the board cut a couple weeks ago with no new hires allowed. So when you see one of our federal employees that are working hard to bring us life, health, and safety, and working out there for us. We owe them a debt of gratitude. They're doing a lot more with a lot less. And with that, I'd like to turn this over to a person who's become a really good friend, a mentor, a go-to in my office on climate change, St. Thomas Dr. John Abraham.
So when you suggest a town hall meeting on climate change, you don't anticipate standing room around, sitting around the side.
Excuse me,
right? Yeah.
He's
pretty
good.
Yeah.
Right,
it's a pleasure to get up here and talk about the science of climate change. We just heard about some of the politics and some of the legislative activities that are going on around climate change. And that's really important. It's really important to know what is being done, what can be done on this topic. I approach this issue from a different vantage point. I approach it from a scientific vantage point, and from where I look at it, carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases are not Democrat or Republican. They're there. And what I look at is, what can I measure in the Earth system that tells me whether or not this is happening, and how bad will it be, and how can we be best informed to make decisions? I've put this information up here. I'm going to go through some science pretty quickly, but feel free to Google me. I do write for The Guardian, weekly articles on climate change. You can Google John Abraham Guardian, John Abraham St. Thomas, you'll find me. I will be happy to share any of this stuff with people. I'll be happy to answer questions. I get about 200 a day, so please be flexible. We know that, but why do we know it's humans? Because it has the fingerprints of human warming. The Earth can warm for a variety of reasons. The sun could get warmer, we could have changes of ice and clouds, but they all have fingerprints on them. And what we're seeing have the fingerprints of greenhouse gas emissions. And this is actually the key of why we're so certain. This is a very famous graph called the Keeling Curve. This shows carbon dioxide measurements. They've been taken since 1957. Famous curve, it may disappear because the funding to take these measurements is under threat. But what we've seen is an increase in carbon dioxide, which is one of the most important greenhouse gases, of about 40%. There's no doubt that greenhouse gases are going up. So what? Greenhouse gases are going up. Well, what's happening with the temperature? This is another graph, a very famous graph, comes out every year, comes out in January. I'm very afraid this is the last time you see it, because a vote was passed in the House last week to instruct NASA, to defund NASA's climate budget. So this graph comes from NASA, maybe the last time you see it. That's 2016. Here are the hottest years on record, in order, going back to 1880. Random? Natural? I'll let us all be our individual judges. This is what we've seen for the last 1,000 years. That's the next century. But what we want to know is not what an abstract temperature is going to do. We want to know, how is it going to impact me? Well, this is what 2012 was like in the United States. Every state that's red had their hottest year on record. That pattern led to this. This drought, this is from the U.S. Drought Monitor, the darker colors are more severe drought. That drought was a $35 billion cost to our economy. Okay? But what we're seeing is not just that things are getting hotter and drier, we're seeing things happen with bigger swings. Just like in Minnesota, we went from really warm last week to snow again tomorrow. We're seeing really big swings. So imagine this map. Wherever it's red, that's hot and dry. This is what happened a few months later. The blue and purple was incredible precipitation. But then what happened out in the west, in California, did incredible drought. So this pattern changed to that. So we're getting a whiplash, a weather whiplash effect. That is the worst drought in California in 1,200 years. All right, what did we see last week? We saw a drought in California? Yeah, right. These are from last week. 190,000 people had to be evacuated part of California because of flooding. So again, we're seeing a swing from one extreme to the other, back to the extreme, and we're seeing that here in Minnesota, but we're also seeing it in the U.S. broadly and worldwide. This has economic consequences. This is incredibly expensive, and it's only the tip of the iceberg. This is going to be worse. So, when tomorrow's snow comes, for anyone older than me, this is John Stewart. Well, you're not older than me. But don't be confused by weather, and don't confuse it with climate. Just because it was warm last week doesn't mean the earth is warming. And just because we're going to have snow tomorrow doesn't mean global warming ended. What we like to look at is the long-term trends. So be mindful of people that use an event as evidence. Then he talked about some of the other effects, and I'm going to now go outside of our borders a little bit. This is a view of the Arctic. The stuff in white is the Arctic ice around 1980. It was the equivalent of the U.S. minus Arizona. That's how much we lost by 2005. That's how much we lost by 2007, and since then we've lost Texas. So this puts it into perspective, the equivalent area of the U.S. We've lost about 70% by volume of the summer ice cream. That tells you something's happening. This is a lake on Greenland. Greenland's actually an ice sheet. If you look in the back, you can see an ice sheet. And there's a motorboat on the lake. Let's go to the South Pole briefly. And again, I know I'm going through this stuff quick. Write to me if you want these slides. The Larsen B ice shelf is a typical ice shelf on the South Pole. Here's a series of satellite images taken over the course of a month and a half. Collapsed into the ocean. How much was that? There's Rhode Island superimposed on that ice shelf. An ice shelf, this shocked scientists. How could an ice shelf that's been around for 2,000 years collapse in a month? I'm going to show you some before and after pictures of glaciers, some of them in the U.S. The cameras are always from the same location, so you can see the effect. And some are in, this one is in Europe. So we're seeing ice be lost, we're seeing changes of drought, changes of flooding patterns. So what does this mean to us? This is the southeastern U.S. with 1 meter sea level rise, which is what we expect by 2100. We're going to have a meter, which is just over 3 feet. That's 3 meters. We could have up to 6 meters by 2100. Miami is a lost city. Let me tell you why Miami's lost. You can't build a seawall around it because the ground is porous. So Miami is a city that's got a short life. This is 6 meters of seawall. But it's not just the U.S. This is a topological map of part of Asia with a focus on Bangladesh, colored by how close it is to sea level rise. We expect at least a meter by 2100. 150 million people worldwide live within a meter of sea level rise. 20 million in Bangladesh. When Betty talked about a threat multiplier, something in the defense industry is concerned about, this is the kind of thing they're concerned about. What do you do if you're India and you've got 20 million climate refugees on your border? That is a real security concern. So what do we do? Well, first we start out by supporting people who take tough votes. And there were a lot of your colleagues who've taken really tough votes over the past decade, and even longer. But we can take action. If we do nothing, our emissions are going to rise over the next 40, 50 foreseeable future. But we can do a bunch of little things that add up. So we think of this as not a silver bullet, but silver buckshot. And a lot of things we're already doing. A lot of things are easy to do. So for example, if you can sell energy, you can get on the wind source program. My house is entirely wind powered, and it costs me about 60 cents extra a month. You can drive a more efficient car and have extra money at the end of the month. So there's a lot of things that we can do that not only will add to one of these reductions, but will make our pocketbook thicker. We talked about the economics. The thing that gives me the most hope is the economics are so much in favor of renewable energy. the cost of wind and solar in particular have fallen through the floor over the past years. I want to focus just on those numbers. This is fossil fuel technologies. Look at those numbers. That LCOE is levelized cost of it's levelized cost. It's just think of it as the cost. And then that's wind and solar. They're almost equal, and that's before you get to the tax credits. So right now, wind and solar's catching up. They're comparable to fossil fuels. Change is possible. I love the figure on the left. It's a rusty oil well, foreground, beautiful wind turbines. And I think this is in Texas, in the back of Texas. It's actually the number one source of wind power. I think Iowa's number two, maybe California is, but states are really entering the renewable energy issue. It's actually funny you mentioned that the Donald Trump hoax thing. I work in renewable energy around the world, and the Chinese are laughing at us. If you go out and try to buy solar panels outside the US, they're all Chinese. They are owning us in terms of developing the industries that are going to create the jobs in the future. They think it's pretty, it's ironic that we blame them if they're going to be the beneficiaries. The guy on the right has algae-based biofuel. Algae that pull CO2 out of the atmosphere, and then you can put it in carbon. I've got two more slides, and this one is the primary human slide. So, yeah, I'm a scientist, and I'm, you know, not very good socially, but I'm also a dad. And I've got these two daughters. This is Lily. She's my crazy wild child. She always misbehaves, wakes up at three, starts reading silently under her covers. This is Olivia, the pensive, thoughtful, quiet girl. And they're going to ask that question when I get older. They're going to say, when they go, Dad, you knew. What did you do about it? And I've had the great fortune recently to be able to take my family on some really exotic trips as they join me developing energy in developing parts of the world. And we've seen, by the way, this is a picture of my daughter, my third daughter, who's adopted from Uganda. We have seen, she's now Minnesotan. We have seen the kind of wildlife and treasures this earth has to offer that we're concerned won't be around. So it's going to affect us here, but it also affects people in wildlife and biodiversity around the world. And it really affects the birth home of my daughter, Uganda. They're a subsistence agricultural society. They are already being economically affected by this. That was a photograph of us with a Maasai in a Maasai village who are also being affected. Last May, I adopted my second daughter, so now four and I'm done. But she is from Atlanta, Georgia. And this tells us something about legacy. I mean, we want to be able to be proud as we talk to our family. We want to create jobs. We want to improve the world. And there's a reason to do it. The takeaway from my talk, before we get to the real celebrity here, Mark Seeley, four things to remember. We know, we've actually known about climate change for over 150 years. Al Gore did not invent it. We can solve it. We can actually solve it today with today's technology. We don't need to wait for aliens or pixie dust to solve it. We can do it today. And if we're smart, we can not only solve the climate problem, but we can create jobs, improve national security, diversify our energy supply. So there's all these other benefits. And lastly, for anyone who tells you it's too expensive to take action, I say it's too expensive not to. Superstorm Sandy was $65 billion. The drought in 2012 was $35 billion. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. If we do nothing, that is a choice, and it's a choice with consequences. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mark, and thank you very much.
Database for 40 years, and I with my working partners mentioned earlier in the State Climate Office and the National Weather Service, I've been able to document our history about as thoroughly as it's possible to document it. And so I brought my recognition of the Minnesota Weather Almanac with the Minnesota Historical Society press release a couple of years ago. And I wanted to start off with a simple story. So my career as a faculty member has been about engaging Minnesota citizens near and far about climate literacy, climate history, climate consequence. And I've spent the better part of my adult life doing that and witnessing what it means to various communities, small and large, and also witnessing the changes in our Minnesota climate firsthand in terms of what our measurements show. Many of you have heard me speak on that and know that our measurement history is a rich one in the state of Minnesota, all of which has been digitized thanks to the work of our State Climate Office. And one of the reasons Minnesota Historical Society asked me to revise the original Minnesota Weather Almanac, which was published in 2006, was simply the acknowledgement that our climate is changing so rapidly. So in the years between 2006 and 2015, when this second edition was produced, for example, in our weather observation network, in Minnesota, we set over 17,000 daily climate records. That's a huge number. We also set 155 statewide records. We measured things on the Minnesota landscape that had never been measured anywhere on the Minnesota landscape. And so this record-setting pace, it dawned on me, is really running away from us. And so I took 2 years to revise this, and I want to use some of the material from it to share with you. This is from our State Climate Office, and it's simply a depiction of all of the pooled data, so all observations in the state, aggregated into what we call a statewide mean value for annual temperature and annual precipitation. So on the vertical axis here above the flat horizontal line would be wet years, depicted years that were wetter than average. And if we look at the central vertical line and we look to the right of it, those would be years that were warmer than what the historical average was. And each dot would represent an individual year in our record back to 1895. So you see a scatter there. Those of you used to working with statistics see a pretty wide scatter in those data. If we overlay those data with all the records since 1987, you suddenly see a pattern emerge towards wetness and warmth. All of the years since 1987 are depicted there in red, and you will note that the vast, vast majority of them are on the warm side of the distribution and the wet side of the distribution. That is the pronounced direction those two attributes of our Minnesota climate is moving. It's moving in those directions very, very rapidly. We also need to acknowledge that that's not the case every place else. We all have relatives and friends that live in other sections of our country. However, we should acknowledge that we happen to live in a part of the American landscape that is experiencing pronounced temperature change. It is shown on this map here from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Those areas of the American landscape highlighted here in pink and red are those areas that are warming the fastest. And so we see there's a political sentiment expressed in this slide as well. In that we all know that the conservative view, especially the conservative voice in Congress, when it comes to denying this attribute, change in our American climate, is often from one of the southeastern states where, in fact, their data show little or no change in the temperature attributes. There's our pooled data for Minnesota. Our pooled data for Minnesota are upward in the temperature distribution. The skewed distribution here, as we say, is weighted to a lot of warm years, which you see on the right side. We've been living through more warm years than any other generation of Minnesotans. We also dissect that to show a trend that we've talked about a lot in recent years, and it fits well with what John just talked to you about. A lot of the mid and high latitude positions in the Earth climate system are showing temperature change, and it's, by the way, all positive, as you can see in the graphic there, more pronounced in the season of short days and long nights than the summer season, but nevertheless, it's there, evident in the statistics of every month, but it's far more amplified in the nighttime minimum than the daytime maximum. And by the way, this was predicted by the climate modelers. So what I want you to absorb is this lesson that those of us engaged in the measurement of climate and those engaged in the modeling of climate converge on this. This is a point of convergence. When the models show us and tell us to expect something we actually measure, that's a highlight. When we all get together, that's something we pat each other on the back about. Okay, and that's clearly what's happening. Clearly what's happening. And the measurements of our temperature change so profoundly. The nice thing about working at a land-grant institution at the University of Minnesota is I get to engage with about every kind of scientific discipline you can imagine. And so in my interaction, I suddenly learn all these very logical and coherent consequences are happening in both the natural and constructive world that are a direct result of the change in our measured temperature environment. So we see a whole variety of lists that's playing out. This is playing out now. This is not something we're waiting for. This is not expected climate change. This is climate change that is occurring now and occurring in an accelerated manner. And so it's really having consequences in all these areas. I don't need to reiterate them. I'm sure in your own personal lives, you can cite some other very specific examples of what you see happening in the world around you that is a result of the change in our climate, particularly the temperature attribute. Moisture, again, wetter. So if you look, again, you see in the distribution across our nation's landscape, we occupy an area of the American landscape that is getting wetter. It's getting very, very much pronounced wetter. Here's the upward trend with a lot of wet years, again, skewed to our lifetime. And there's no denying this. This is what the data show. We are blessed in Minnesota. Our Minnesota culture is one in which we have over 1,500 volunteer precipitation observers. And we are able to look at all those data and assess all those data with very, very, very good resolution as we look at the Minnesota landscape. Our current landscape now, as you can see in the sequence of maps, we have over half the Minnesota landscape now that experiences over 29 inches of annual precipitation. The light and dark blue regions on these maps. That is distinctly a different feature of our climate than it was years and centuries ago. We also see that what we once called normal has changed. And all of you probably saw the headline from last year with our observer Waseca reporting a new all-time state record of 56.24 inches of precipitation last year. Waseca, Minnesota was wetter than Birmingham, Alabama last year. And you can see that we migrated to a situation, and this is another important undercurrent or message in our everyday lives that should resonate with all of us. As we listen to the meteorologists on TV, or as we read in the newspaper that last year was 2 inches wetter than normal, please bear in mind that that's 2 inches wetter than a normal, that is wetter than the prior normal, that is wetter than the prior normal, that is wetter than the prior normal. you see, that buffers the true amplitude of how wet we've become. And so when we use these normals, the most recent three complete decades, we kind of disguise the net real change in those values. Another thing we've talked about a lot in our own Minnesota backyards is not only the change in the central character of the climate attribute, but the extremes and the distribution. So one area that's gained a lot of attention in recent years is the extremes related to precipitation. Now, our American Association of State Climatologists has done a study to look at what we call extreme mega rain frequency. Mega rain is defined as 6 inches or greater, encompassing 1,000 square mile area, a big swath with a central core value of 8 inches. Here's a simple listing from the State Climate Office of those events in our history. The first 140 years of our state history, we had 7 events, all very destructive in Minnesota. Since 2002, we've had 7 more. This is very disturbing. This has garnered the attention of the, for example, Minnesota Association of Floodplain Managers. This has garnered the attention, for example, of the Minnesota Insurance Federation. This has garnered the attention of the Minnesota Department of Transportation, which builds our bridges and culverts and things like that. So this is another very important feature to grasp. And the geographic distribution of these storms is not weighted or concentrated on any one area. These types of storms have occurred in almost every section of the Minnesota landscape. So we need to be wary of that. And that too plays out in consequences. And the consequences are very real and they're very coherent for our lives. We have to pay attention to that. My last words, and by the way, this is my 40th and last year as a faculty member at the U. My last words to you are this. We need to stay engaged on this. We need to all pay attention, talk with our neighbors, whether urban or greater Minnesota dwellers. Talk to our neighbors, make sure we understand what's going on in our own backyard, and work on this. If our leaders won't pay attention, we need to work on this from the ground up. Local watershed districts, public works departments, city councils, mayor offices, and in that venue since 2008, I've been privileged to be part of your Minnesota Climate Adaptation Partnership Program. Now, the reason I'm bringing that up is for the first time in history, Minnesota is hosting the National Adaptation Forum. It only occurs every 2 years, and we're hosting it this year at the River Center in downtown St. Paul, May 8th through 11th. There's going to be over 1,000 people there from all over the nation. And this is a wonderful opportunity for you to hear about the practice of climate adaptation. Because it's not going to be all academics. It's going to be community leaders, NGOs, even faith leaders. Paul Douglas and I are leading a session on faith-based climate adaptation. We're going to hear about doing something about this. And that's a wonderful opportunity for you to engage, and we need to have more of this engagement. So I want you to be aware of that. Look for that on the web. The Adaptation Forum, May 8th through 11th at the River Center in downtown St. Paul. And thank you for the privilege of talking to you. Thank you for the privilege of being your public servant the last 40 years.
And I don't see a clock in the back, so I'm going to ask
Herald for coming and setting everything up and all the work that you've done on this. Herald, would you let us know, maybe we have 5 minutes left to wrap up? And you talked so much about precipitation. Mr. City, would you like some water?
Yes, that sounds good.
So we have more people at just pop up, start, and then we'll alternate mics. So people start right here. So if you just gave me your first name and your city, and go.
Hi, my name is Peter. I live in St. Paul. And to me, the most fundamental problem is obviously working with the non-believers. And my comment is more of a comment than a question. I mean, obviously, CO2 causes warming. And even, I believe it's man-made now. But to talk to the non-believers, if we can frame it as, even if it's not man-made up to this point, that does not mean we can keep pouring CO2 into the atmosphere. If we keep pouring CO2 into the atmosphere, it will become man-made. So I guess what I'm suggesting is, if we can kind of shift the dialogue for the non-believers to try to convince them that, okay, maybe it's not man-made now, but if we keep going on with the status quo, it will become man-made. So that's kind of my recommendation. And if there are natural changes, we're just going to worsen. We'll just worsen those natural changes.
I think I'm in. Thanks for that. So I give a lot of talks to a wide variety of audiences, and I'm sure that we experience this in our own lives. I mean, some people are motivated to take action because they're concerned about the climate, but other people aren't, or they're skeptical about it. But that's an opportunity to make bridges. My suggestion to you is try to approach a problem from a trusted vantage point. Some people may not care about the climate, but they might care about jobs. They might care about they might be hunters or fishermen, and they may care about what this is doing to hunting and fishing. They may care about agriculture. They may be people of faith. They may be interested in the defense industry. Why is the defense industry so worried about this? So, bombing people with facts. Look, carbon dioxide is a human-emitted greenhouse gas. I am 100% certain humans are causing global warming. 100% certain. In fact, I have a paper coming out in Science March 10th, which is, if that's not the proof, then nothing can be the proof. But my wife says you can't bomb people with facts. You can approach it from different vantage points that they will be more receptive to. So my suggestion is to use that strategy when you talk to people.
We'll go to the back, Mike. We'll alternate mics, okay?
Thanks.
Hi.
Hi, I am Cal. I'm from St. Paul, and I am a botanist. Much like Mark Lovey. I'm here actually with a possible opportunity for you. Some of my colleagues have been involved with the development of the Botanical Society Sciences and Native Plant Materials Research Restoration and Promotion Act. This actually has a number. It's House Bill 54. It is a bipartisan bill. Quickly and Ross Lakeland, so Illinois and Florida. And this bill is a jobs creation bill. It is an education support bill. It is an interspecies relations bill. So this is designed to help support the continuation of botany in this era of climate change, with understanding that currently nearly half of our botanical capacity in the United States is going to be retiring in the next 10 years. I would love to ask you to co-sponsor the bill.
Pressure.
I took earth science in high school, but I'm listening to the mountains very thank you, and we will look into it, and I think we've got the number written down. Josh or somebody or one of my staff will contact you. And just a footnote on this, there are literally sometimes hundreds of bills introduced every day, and different authors have different ways of letting people know about them. So if you ever see that I'm not on something, please don't hesitate to email, call the office, and let us know. because there's a whole lot going on, and we want to know about the good stuff we can be part of, so thank you.
Right, especially to be bipartisan in this time is quite an opportunity.
Yes, and this Ross Blayton's from Florida, which we saw going underwater.
Good afternoon, my name is Garcia Paul, and I do a lot of work in the project. My question is about the economics, because as we have heard, I've heard many times that the cost of renewable energy is dropping so quickly that power companies are figuring out that they can make more money by doing renewable energy. Do you see this as a hopeful way to go around the effort to reduce the funding of such activities? The naysayers slowing us down?
Well, I just want to, I'm going to let these two gentlemen kind of comment on this, the trends that are happening. But here's my perspective from the United States being a leader in making sure that we continue to have a first-class, world-class economy. We have to be encouraging the science, the scientists, the engineers, the mechanical engineers, the laborers. There are lots of jobs to be had out there, and I want the United States to be first in solar panels. I want the United States to be first in wind turbines, and I want them made as much as possible here, right here at home. Right now, as John pointed out, China floods the market on solar panels. We know we can make better solar panels. In fact, we do make better solar panels. But we haven't been supporting the industry in the way that we need to do that. And fossil fuels still gets a large subsidy, and they're doing fine. That subsidy was put in back in the days when the Wildcat oil drillers were out there and, you know, it was risking life and limb. They don't need the subsidy anymore. We need to level the playing field, and one of the things that I've been trying to do is shift some of that funding over to help it to do the science, the engineering, and also if we're going to do tax credits to make it to work with homeowners, to work with people in the building industry, as well as the people who do the jobs in the building industry, to retrofit our schools in that same tax credit.
I'll answer it, but I'm also going to mention that Mark Seeley's got a lead soon. So if anyone has a Minnesota letter question, I think your question will be up, maybe one more question or so. So if there's a Minnesota letter question, make that next. The economics is what gets me most excited. Building a coal power plant right now is really risky because you're investing in an infrastructure that's got to be around for 30 or 40 years, and the economics are worse and worse every year. And so if you look at the cost of delivering wind and solar, especially microgrid stuff, it is moving fast in the direction of renewables. And I've got a lot of friends in China, a lot of climate scientists, a lot of energy people. I want them to buy my technology. I don't want to buy their technology. So this really has a future jobs of America component to it. Is there anyone in mind with a Minnesota weather question?
We have one down, right down here.
Yes, I have a question.
You can take that down towards you.
I have a question for Mr. Seeley. One of my concerns in terms of environmental pollution are toxic chemicals used in the agricultural landscape, lawn, gardening. Do you see Minnesota capable of banning such things and supporting organic farming as opposed to our corporate-type farming that now exists in the state?
I'm not the commissioner of agriculture.
I understand that.
I do work with agriculture, and I see a migration towards a more sustainable, environmentally friendly agriculture. I see a migration towards that. It's not moving as fast as most people would like. our philosophy with working with the Minnesota Department of Agriculture has been to deploy new knowledge about these chemicals and their fate in the environment. Lots of studies. But deploy that knowledge by, first off, revealing what the negative consequences are, and then looking at practicing what we call best management practices. Now, we also need to acknowledge that doesn't always work, especially on the large scale of commercial operations that a lot of our farms operate on. And so regulation may in fact come. In fact, slowly but surely we see evidence for it. But I don't think it's suddenly going to be put upon our producers. But I see a lot of community by community, and I see a lot of producers seeing their role within the community to be a sustainable and environmentally friendly producer of a commodity. And more of them are thinking that way. So we are migrating in that direction, but I see that playing out over quite a long period of time.
So perhaps the only way we can encourage moving that more quickly is consumer demand for organic products.
I think that is already, actually I think that's already happening. Certainly we see that in the grower associations we work with around the state. They're already feeling that, so you're quite right. I think coming from the consumer side is a way to add pressure to accelerate that process.
Thank you, and Mark, thank you so much for joining us today, and I know you'll be leaving, and I listen to you whether I'm in Minnesota or in Washington, D.C., because as I can listen to NPR online, so thank you.
And will you come to an event when I'm celebrating my 40th year of
I'll show up with my water.
Question. We're going to have a gentleman in front of me with a wonderful green sweater on, and then, ma'am, you're next. Okay, sir.
Well, Congresswoman, I first just wanted to thank you for your leadership on this issue, for holding an event like this. Highlighting the dire national security implications of this issue, and then I wanted to urge you to join and find a Republican to join the Climate Solutions Caucus with you. The caucus has doubled in size since the election, adding on average a Republican member a month, which is a great sign of hope. So I just want to urge you to do that, and I want you to just comment a little bit and speak to your efforts across the aisle, which is one of the things that will accelerate progress.
I work across the aisle in the defense committee. I'm always bringing everything up, you know, icebreakers, Arctic. I mean, my colleagues on the other side know we're going to talk about climate change and its impacts on national security. And, you know, I've approached a couple of them. Maybe you can help me with one of our Minnesota members. I'm ready to join. So, and your first name?
Peter.
Hi, Peter. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Representative McCollum, my name is Mary, and I'm from Shoreview. I'm also a member of Citizens Climate Lobby, like that last young man. And I echo his sentiments. I'd also like to urge you to join the House Climate Solutions Caucus. You talked a few seconds ago about firsts. Most of the members on that caucus are from the coastal states, five alone from Florida. We need someone from the Midwest, and I'd like to see a Minnesotan be the first from the Midwest. Because they'll be talking about solutions to climate change, and you would bring to that caucus putting a price on carbon, and specifically carbon fee and dividend. Thank you so much. Appreciate all your work.
Thank you. Maybe deciding the date.
It might be worthwhile.
to mention what cap and dividend is. So there's a number of ways to promote effective use of our energy sources and renewable energy. One way is to put a carbon tax. And so that's got some pros and cons to it. Another method is a cap and dividend. Now, the way that would work is January 1, everyone will get a check, $1,500. And things that are carbon intensive would become more expensive because there would be a producer tax. So gas, as an example, will become more expensive. But people who made good choices over the year and use their energy more wisely would actually come out economically ahead. And people who made poor environmental choices would come out economically behind. So it's not a tax from the rich to the poor, from the poor to the rich, it's from the dumb to the smart. So that it will reward people, it wouldn't increase the deficit, it wouldn't decrease the deficit, but it would reward individuals for making smart choices, and you could come out economically. And that's the essence of a cap and dividend. And I, as a scientist, love the idea. It's got a lot of strengths to it. Oh, this is going to be a shocker. Okay.
There are 18,000 factory farms in the state of Minnesota, and we have a huge egg political power in the state. This is animal protection. They are polluting our land, our air, and our water. Can you address how this is affecting our land?
So, agriculture is a major source of greenhouse gases, in particular methane, but also in the production of crops, there's a lot of vehicular use. It's a component. On the other hand, we need to eat. So the question is, well, what are some smart things that we can do? And there's some low-hanging fruit that makes a lot of economic sense. As one example, eating meat, especially red meat, especially cows, is very energy wasteful compared to growing grains. Now, I love dirt. I love steak as well. But if we all did our jobs, cut back a little bit, we could be healthier, there would be less meat. So that's one idea. But Minnesota can actually be a producer of less polluting fuels. Corn ethanol, I've been studying in 2009 about the impacts of corn ethanol. We can actually create corn ethanol, and it's not clean, but it's about 15 to 20% less than fossil fuels when you include all of the production. So we can actually turn agriculture into a semi-clean energy production source as a bridge fuel to more clean energy. So there's a lot of potential. But I'll tell you something about agriculture. Those folks, especially people who farm, they understand the impact of climate on their livelihood, so they are a untapped great resource for working people.
And we'll go back to the second one.
I'm Zach, I'm a student here at St. Thomas, and I have two questions. The first one is specifically for the Congresswoman. With the exception of tax credits and other government subsidies, what are you doing to encourage investment in innovation and education? Sustainable energy production.
Well, what we like to do and something that we work on at the digital program here in St. Thomas is the STEAM and STEM programs, getting more of our young adults interested in engineering, because what I'm finding is a lot of young adults like yourself, you want to be part of the solution on what to do about climate change. So there's a hunger out there to have an opportunity to be innovators and creators and to come up with solutions on it. So we need to focus some of our resources as a federal government into whether it's a land grant institution or doing grants with one of the privates here in the Twin Cities or somewhere around the United States, and encouraging that kind of innovation and encourage that kind of science to take place and to be developed. And so I just don't talk about STEM, I like to talk about STEAM, because I like to put the arts in there, because a lot of what we need to do is to have real creative thinkers out there. John, are there things that you think that if we can get this administration to invest in education and higher education, do you have some suggestions for me specifically?
I'm going to have to think about some suggestions, some specific suggestions, but one thing I will say is St. Thomas, we have a faculty member here who has a major grant in collaboration with Xcel Energy to develop microgrid energy, distributed energy solutions, Greg Mallory, electrical engineer, widely regarded in this area. So St. Thomas, from a technical standpoint, is developing the solutions that are going to help us lead ourselves to the clean and profitable energy future. So you should be proud to be a St. Thomas student.
Great question, thank you.
So what can be done to make wind and other sustainable energy methods less cost prohibitive so that they can compete better with the better established fossil fuels?
Well, as I showed earlier, wind is basically beating coal now, and the costs are going down because coal is a really old technology. It's hard to make it more efficient, but wind turbines are getting bigger, they're getting longer lasting, the more efficient generation. One thing that's got, so wind will in the end beat fossil fuels in terms of economics alone. But one thing that I'm really interested in is what's called distributed energy production. So rather than having a plant that services a bunch of areas, or a wind farm that services a bunch of areas, distribute the power production, because then when the wind isn't blowing in one area or the sun isn't shining in one area, it's shining or blowing somewhere else. And the more distributed you have, the more efficient it is, but also the higher rates, the less costly and more efficient. You don't have long transmission lines, and you distribute in terms of the weather. So I'm really excited about that, and Minnesota's leader in distributed energy.
My name is Luis Oviedo, president of the city of St. Paul. Thank you guys for your time today and your service to the public in general. The question, there was something that you said, Congresswoman, about kind of being on the defensive, and I think that more so than now, I think action is kind of what everybody is wanting. Not only from our delegation in the city of Minnesota, but in general, because it looks like states are going to be leading this charge more so than not. So, is there any effort on your part or the part of the rest of the Minnesota delegation to kind of push this agenda forward more clearly? And you were talking about a list of items and things that might be actionable, different things that we should know. Would there be an opportunity to have you post those things for those of us at the end of this meeting? Because I do a ton of stuff. So I want to just make sure that, like, we have a to-do list after this, right? Because all of us are engaged. And I think that at this point, it's about finding out what's actionable and what we do next. We're not getting it from the Fed.
We'll work on that together. I think that's a great solution. Both of us have websites. I'm on the defense for letting anybody take us backwards. So I'm down there, and I'm going to make sure that, you know, we have a bottom line for what we have at the EPA, and there's no backsliding on it. But I'm on the offense about talking about this and raising public awareness and getting my colleagues to do more on it.
And something you can do immediately is two things. You can talk to your family and friends about it. Let them know that this is an important issue, and you raise it at conversations. That's really important. And also, I was trying to say this, call your representative. I heard that if one or two people call, they're cranks, but if five call, it's ground stuff.
Not you.
So if, you know, get out there, call, take your, especially state reps too, as state senators, take them out to coffee, talk to them about why this matters, and I think the elected officials will quickly see that this is something that constituents want.
So this is a good problem. We have more questions than we have time for, but here's what I'd like to do. For those of you who are here, I have staff in the room and staff out there. If you want to address a question to us or have us follow back up with you, you have my Girl Scout honor, and John and I will get back to you. So I'm not going to choose between the two microphones, so if the young woman in front and the young man in the back, if you both state your question one after the other, We'll end with that. So I want to thank people for coming. For those of you who are in line, I'm very serious. I have Josh Straka back there that is in my staff, and if we'll figure out a way to communicate and get back to you to answer your question. Please.
Hi, thank you. you so much for being here today. This is really encouraging at a time that politics isn't seeming so encouraging. I'm Isabella, I'm an Alistair student, and I know that in the polling data in the U.S. Citizens, there's a gender gap on that. Women are so much more conservative than men, and so I'm wondering what's something that you see in the legislature.
Yes, I have not seen that in Minnesota, because I think we're all concerned about the climate, and as you can see, there's a diverse age group here. I'm concerned about it. Yeah, it's very interesting, and as a social studies teacher, I find that very intriguing, and I want to learn more about that. So maybe you could give us your information, I can just talk for you. Sir, you have the last word.
Hi, I'm Ryan from Vegan. My question is more the short-term impact and the actions we're implementing to respond to the effects of climate change, i.e. how are we helping our Earth Food Services sort of help with, you know, these excessive rains here and drought out west, you know, to that extent, and where we're kind of concentrating our services and dollars and responding and helping our communities in response to this, which is happening. It's not going to, you know, appear to stop soon, right? So we're going to be able to respond. Thank you.
Well, what I'm seeing nationally, because the Department of Interior, we fund the National Parks, the Forest Service, and the Fish and Wildlife, the Bureau of Land Management, and the Department of Agriculture, which has a little bit of Forestry Service in it too, it's looking at too. Every time there's a wildland fire, U.S. taxpayers are paying for it. We'll be in Washington, yeah. And we're hearing weather forecasts here, and all of a sudden Tim Walz has flooded out of their homes. Colin's talking about what's going on with the farming up there. We know that there's short-term consequences to these weather swings that we're seeing. But no one is putting the price in tying it to climate change. And that's what we have to do. That's what I'm trying to do in the Department of Defense by asking the pointed questions I am with my colleagues. But we also need to do that here at home. We need to pay attention to Republicans and Democrats when it comes to what's happening with wildland fires and its relation to drought and what that's doing to the federal budget. Sandy was mentioned as an example. But do you have any other suggestions about how we can collect data and really get it out there for these short-term consequences?
In terms of the state, that would be consulted through the state legislature. I don't know who that is, but I'm sure we'll call Mark Seeley because he knows everything that's random. Thank you for that question. I shouldn't have said that because that made you sound like your question was random, but it wasn't. I want to thank everyone for coming. It's been really great, really energizing to see everyone here. Thank you so much. And I have to be the bearer of bad news. We need to be somewhat efficient as we get out of here because there's another event shortly after this one. I know that there's a lot of setting up that has to be done. I've got some cards here. Betty's got her staff here, so we can make some connections afterwards. Thank you.